doing every possible signal I could ever imagine. Any signal I've ever seen, any signal that we've done, any signal any other team's done, and any variation of any signal.
And this is the 111 show. Welcome back. Now, today, Netflix dropped the Connor Stalions documentary, Untold, Sign Stealer. Last year, as we know, Michigan won a national championship, but it did not come without controversy, and some will say an asterisk. Connor Stalions was outed as a scout for the Michigan football team, and former head coach Jim Harbaugh is saying that, or he said that he had no involvement with this, and Connor Stalions was a rogue agent. I don't know why it's so hard for me to say that, but it's hard to believe. One, because they allowed him to be on the staff, on the sideline, talking to coaches. Now, do I think they know the extent? Because in the documentary, they lay out these spreadsheets, and he is in front of the camera, just like me, doing these signals. He's doing these signals on all of these coaches. Hey, he's doing this. That's this play. Got the formations in there. Got what the plays is. He's buying tickets for people. So, as someone who roots for Michigan, it's hard to be like, Jim Harbaugh didn't know anything. But at the same, in the same breath, I want to say, I don't think it should take away from the players who had to lift, watch film, make the plays, be lined up, execute. Like, they didn't ask for this. And I don't want that to get lost, that these players had to put in the work and do what they needed to do to win these games. Because as we know, in college football especially, like, if you're bigger, faster, stronger, I'll say it again, if you're bigger, faster, stronger than your opponent, you're going to beat them. And last year, and a lot of times, they looked bigger, faster, stronger. You can go back to the last three or four games where it's Maryland, where it's Penn State, where it's Ohio State, Iowa, Alabama. Big games where this was already out in the open. And people come through. And Michigan came through and executed, bro. So, watching the doc, it comes out that it could have been from Ohio State that ousted all of this information and had a data leak and hacked his computer and found all this information and turned it out. This is all alleged. None of this is proven. But it's a lot of things that seem fishy about Ohio State's involvement or an Ohio State fan's involvement. So to that, I would say, what would make you any better than what Connor Stalions did? Because not only now you taking it outside of football, I think it was upwards to like 200,000. I'll put the graphic up later, but like it's a lot of people whose data got breached. And as this goes beyond a football game. So majority of sports fans, I would say, or sports or coaching staffs, they would have loved to have a Connor Stalions. If you looked at what he did, and let's say it wasn't a rule. He wasn't breaking a rule. He was just scouting. He wasn't buying people's tickets. He was just breaking down the sideline film and deciphering signs. What he did was extremely impressive. If you watch the documentary again and go to his system and how he did it and how he helped the team, super passionate Michigan fan, way more passionate than I will ever be in my lifetime. But he wanted to see Michigan to the mountaintop. And it was just funny to see how bittersweet it was at the end when he couldn't be on the sideline when they won the national championship. So I'm interested to see a little bit about what Pat McAfee has to say about the situation, because they was featured heavily into this. This turned into a super long intro. I just had to get my initial thoughts out before they got diluted by his, because that was a big part of it. And you can see some of the sensationalized headlines about people speculating about Michigan, and yeah, let's just see what he has to say.
via Netflix, Untold. It was Connor Stalions' story. It was quite a buzz around the internet this morning. It's an hour and 27 minutes long, so we didn't get a chance to watch the entire thing as we're piecing together this morning's shows, but clips were coming out. And I think the reaction that I've seen thus far, and correct me if I'm wrong, is if you were Harbaugh's a piece of shit, he definitely knew type of person before this documentary, it solidified it. Seemingly, this is the reaction that we're reading on the internet. Yep. And if you think Harbaugh did not know and Connor Stalions was a rogue agent, you feel that way even more after watching it.
For sure.
Correct. I will say, as somebody who is
I would say that's fair based on the evidence they showed from the show. He definitely, to some degree, knew what Connor Stalions was doing. To the extent of his whole operation, I don't know. Buying tickets, I don't know. He could have got a booster to buy the tickets. They pointed the finger at a booster or somebody who was on the board that could have supplied him the funds to buy tickets for other people. But do I think Jim Harbaugh with his credit card was funding this, or with his whatever money he had was funding Connor Stalions?
Listen to Harbaugh speak.
I don't think so.
About this entire process and watch how he reacted to this entire process and how he's continued to maintain his innocence about not knowing what was taking place and how it was taking place. I don't think Harbaugh knew. I have not watched the hour and 27. I will do that this evening. So I might come in tomorrow with a different story. But from the clips that I've seen, this Connor Stalions guy was committed to the Michigan Wolverines.
Yeah. That's one word.
He was elite. He was elite. You can call him what he was, but he was doing it at a high level. He was doing this at an extremely high level. To this scouting stuff that he was doing, I think he was doing this thing. You might be mad about it or whatever you want to say about it, but
I mean, that's what are you saying?
I mean, he was committed, but
you can't be mad at it. You can't be mad at it, man.
Yeah. I mean, but hey, that's what the greatest are, right? That's what it takes. Tom, MJ, Tiger, we all
Stallions. You got to be obsessed with your craft, which Connor Stalions certainly was. There's one particular clip that I think kind of showcases why Connor Stalions' name was mentioned, brought up, and became a massive story. And it took place while he was getting interviewed by the NCAA, I believe, with his lawyer sitting right next to him. It's a longer scene, but here's the part that basically says, yes, I did what everybody kind of was saying that I did.
Connor, did you ever direct anyone or instruct anyone to attend a college football game in which Michigan was not playing?
No, I don't ever recall directing someone to go to a game.
Have you ever purchased tickets for someone to attend a college football game in which Michigan was not playing?
Yeah, I've purchased tickets to many games. College football, obviously Michigan's playing, so I don't have time to go to another game, but I either resell them, or if a friend asks for a ticket, then I transfer it to him or her.
Okay. And would any of those tickets that you purchased that you would then transfer to a friend or a family member, did any of the individuals who you purchased a ticket for attend a game that Michigan was not competing in?
Checklist.
And film or record the opponent's signal callers.
So to my understanding, there are some people who attended games using tickets that I purchased and recorded parts of those games.
It's my understanding.
And who are the individuals that recorded parts of the games that were sitting in seats that you purchased?
I don't recall exactly who. I've purchased tickets to a lot of games.
How do you know they were recording parts of the game then?
Because sometimes I would receive film from them.
I've had a friend send me film. And it's kind of like when your aunt gets you a Christmas present that you already have.
Sure.
You're not going to be rude and be like, oh, I already have this, I don't need it. You know, just, oh, thanks, appreciate it. You know, feel like they're helping out or whatever when I already have the signals. I already memorized the signals. I mean, so just say thanks, whatever, you know.
I mean, all of it is very interesting. He was very open in it all. And obviously that recording was done from the research that the NCAA was gathering while they were doing what they were trying to do and figure out what the punishment's going to be. And obviously we've heard and been told by the authority that's probably going to be a massive financial litigation through it all. But if you listen to him speak there, you could tell he was trying to out-lawyer the lawyers, to my understanding. And then he said, yes, they have sent me film and yada, yada, yada. And you would think to yourself, well, somebody was telling him to do this, right? It's like, not necessarily. Here's another clip from this thing. This guy was obsessed with being the greatest sign decipher of all time. And you say, why do you know, or how?
Honestly, unless somebody show me otherwise, he is the GOAT at this signing business, bro. Like, there's hands down, I've never seen anything like this as far as film breakdown. He's breaking down film better than coaches. If he put this energy towards actually coaching, which in the end of the documentary, this says, I'm spoiling it if you ain't watch it, whatever, you probably could look it up anyway. He's coaching in Detroit for a high school football team. So if he put this effort into those children, into strategy and scheming something up, he could be a very good coach. I'm not going to forecast him his coaching ability.
Listen to what this fucking guy would do. Breaking down film. This guy wanted to be the greatest sign. He'd probably be elite
if he could break down signs like this.
Is what he would describe. Mm-hmm. And I believe his obsession with that led him to the fit. Like, I think he got trapped into, I'm the greatest of all time.
Need to do this.
Listen to this clip and watch what he would actually do. Thousands of signs he said he would do this.
The first thing that I evolved that made me good at deciphering signals was my game day sheet. I took a couple weekends. I found a white wall as the background, and I wore dark clothes to contrast.
Smart.
I propped my phone up and just recorded myself doing every possible signal I could ever imagine.
I don't know what
any signal I've ever seen, any signal that we've done, any signal any other team's done, and any variation of any signal. So I recorded myself doing probably 2,000 to 3,000 signals. When I was done, I uploaded each photo into my sheet where it belonged. I developed my own database, which is the next evolution of my game day sheet.
Like, this is elite. Cheating or not, this is elite. Like, you gotta, like, if you Ohio State fan, you probably hate the man guts. So let's say you root for Hawaii or something. This is elite work right here. It's nasty work. Only look bad, look terrible for Michigan. But bro, this is dedication.
Instead of memorizing words, I was memorizing pictures. And I would say that is the number one reason why I became as good as I did at deciphering signals.
You're talking about thousands of signals he would piece together on his game day board. Instead of, you know, play calls or words, he would just put, obviously, the signs. So then he's watching across the thing. He knows exactly what it is. He's quite a weapon all of a sudden for the Michigan Wolverines as somebody who was in military as opposed to growing up playing in football and coaching in football. And I think what you're hearing in the reaction from everybody is, obviously, this guy was really obsessed with this.
Yeah,
above and beyond. I mean, he was committed to this more than anybody else on earth. But let's listen to Coach T. Mitch here, defensive coordinator for the Arkansas Razorbacks. And if you do recall, he's the one that freestyled in front of the team, and they all said, yeah, coach, in the middle of it, had them all bought in. Here's what he had to say about sign stealing. Once again, remember, dog on the football field as a player, now defensive coordinator in college.
Oh, a lot. Like, it's so funny. You'll be shocked. During the week, I know offense all around the country, they're going to get the TV copy, and they're looking at the signals. Yeah, just one person. That's your only job. Look at the signals. And then, boom. Oh, we can't get the defensive signals. Okay, well, let's see what the defensive players are signaling. Then they'll try to get it that way. You know, so they got different ways. I remember we played Louisville, and he was really good. And I saw the TV copy, and I could just see the whole time. He's just like this. just watching. And then at halftime, they got the signals. So we played him the next year. I was at UCF. We played him that next year, and I got his contact, and I called him. Like, hey, man, I need to. And he sent me the whole thing. And he said, this is what we had. And it was like 80% correct. So we had to change our signals because they just pass it around. So they'll just send it to the next. So we played SMU and Rhett Lashley them, and they had the same signals.
And this is what I be saying, though, about people who ain't really entrenched into the background of football, like the stuff that you don't see on TV every day, the stuff that they won't show you when they shooting documentaries, the nitty gritty, the stuff that GAs be doing. Like, this is something that like a GA will get tasked with. So he just happened to be elite at it. But so this is not going to be national news for Arkansas that they figured out a guy was passing around their signals everywhere. But because it was Michigan, the Ohio State-Michigan rivalry, all of a sudden Michigan was struggling to beat Michigan State consistently and hadn't beat Ohio State in like 13 years. And now they all of a sudden beating them, it makes it look much worse. But if I tell people that it's commonplace in football at all levels, everybody's like, eh, well, they don't really want to hear that. But this is the reality. This is the reality of it. That's why it was dummy signs on the sideline. That's why is they putting mics in the helmets now so we can get rid of this. So it can't be no more goofy signs and people with wristbands and different colored shirts and stuff. So believe what you want, but you're naive to think that this was solely Michigan and that it's not a bigger network of people doing this.
I would have been mad if we didn't change it. So it's huge, like just signals, and it's perfectly legal. I know teams right now that have two guys on the field because you usually have them in the box. So you know how the times you see a lot of these teams behind the actual team, they got these, they pull out these big curtains behind it. If it wasn't important, they wouldn't be doing it. 80% of the teams in America, when they signal, they pull out the big curtain behind so the guys in the press box can't get them. Well, they done smarten up. They done put them on the field. So they got two guys, and they just sit here and try to get it. So you got to have ways of high your signals, you know. So you can always know, like, when a play happened, you go, hey, man, they got our signals. Because it's just like a perfect play. You just know. all over college football. So that's not, man, it's nothing new. It's not one of those deals where it's like, unethical or something like that. Like, they do it. You just, if you're crazy enough to keep the same signals, that's on you.
That's Coach T. Will. I call it T. Mitch. That's 100% on me. But Coach T. Will basically breaking down, I think, what every former player had to say about the sign stealing. I think why the Connor Stalions thing happened is because the advanced scouting rule that was in place. And I think if you were to watch this Untold entirely,
I'm going to leave it there. But to say it again, this is where Connor Stalions, where it went left and it went too far, is where you go on to opponents and recording the other team's games. As a Michigan fan, as someone who roots for Michigan, I'm going to say that was unacceptable. But hey, what's happened has happened. The national championship is won. Jim Harbaugh is gone. Sherrone Moore is the new head coach. JJ McCarthy has graduated. A lot of kids has graduated. They got returners. It's over, but it ain't really over for Michigan. But I'm going to leave it there. This is not uncommon. I said it earlier. They're putting mics and helmets now. So this is going to eliminate all of this sign stealing stuff and all these extra antics that's going around in football games and coach dropping dummy play call sheets and trying to catch people cheating and all this other stuff. So effectively it should be eliminated. I think they still gonna find a way around the communication when they I don't know how reliable those things is. I never had to do any communication like that. But those are my thoughts on the Connor Stalions documentary, bro. It was wild. It was crazy to see the amount of effort he put into it, because I thought it was just recording and then putting it to work. But these Excel sheet docs, and as you can see, the photographs he was taking and sending in to the teams with the formations and tendencies. Absolute dedication. Absolute. He's beyond a Michigan super fan. It's obsession. So with that being said, man, That's my thoughts on the Connor Stalions documentary. I'm about to get us up out of here. Go.